like Brother Dan Mao, he preached in a revival, and he said that they had a different preacher. One night they were swapping out. They'd one preach a while, and then another one preach a while, and then he said it came his turn, and the one that's written for him came down off the podium and told him, said, "Now we got it going. Keep it going now. Keep it going." And he said, "Neither one of them preached like I did." So he said, "I got up there and I just preached like I always did, but I just preached louder." He said, "I just got louder so they could hear me." Amen. Oh, Dan was a scholar, okay? He actually taught in seminary. So, I mean, he really knew the Bible. Let's put it this way. We'll be in Mark, the 4th chapter tonight, when I get there. I run across a story this week. There was a man, he was working, for this organization that actually delivered meals out to the nursing homes and to old people at home. You know, I don't know what they're called, some kind of service they call Meals on Wheels or something like that. So one day, though, he decided he'd take his daughter along with him. She was 4 years old, just to help when she was delivering meals. And there he was. And she was, this little girl, she was intrigued when she'd go to the nursing home, because she'd see all the canes and the walkers and all of the wheelchairs and all of this in the nursing home. And she was amazed. I just kind of focused on it. But then one day she had went into this lady's room, and she seen on a table beside her bed was her false teeth in a glass jar beside her bed, and it had water. Anyway, the father, he was thinking, "I'm just wondering about the questions that's fixing to come from this." So anyway, he waited, and then finally the little girl looked up at him and said, "Daddy, the tooth fairy's never going to believe this." I told this before in here. There's a story of a man that fell off a cliff, and as he was going down, he grabbed the limb on a bush that was sticking out over the cliff, and he was hanging on, and he was hollering, "Help, help, help. Is anybody up there? Help, help, help." Finally, he heard this voice. Said, "I'm here. I am the Lord. Do you believe me?" And the guy answered, "Yes, Lord, yes, I believe you, I believe you." He said, "But can you please do something? My hand is getting, I'm losing grip. I can't hold on any longer." He said, "Son, if you truly believe in me, and that you know that I'll keep you safe, just turn loose." All of a sudden it got silent. Finally, next thing he heard, "Is anybody else up there?" Let me tell you, what's the old expression? When the going gets tough, the tough get going, right? But all too often, so many times, even as Christians, when times get tough, we kind of lose our faith for a little while, don't we? Sometimes our first reaction is to just give up. Fear and panic usually come more naturally than faith does. We have all kinds of fears. I copied down some of these, and I think I can't pronounce them probably correctly. But pelidophobia, and that is a fear of bald people. And then there's porphyrophobia, and that's a fear of the color purple. And then you have chiatophobia, which is a fear of hairy people. Dextrophobia, fear of objects on the right side of your body. Thalassophobia, fear of being seated. Odontophobia, anyone want to guess on that one? It's a fear of teeth. There's even a phobia, it's called phobia phobia. What is it? It's a fear of being afraid. You know, we may not have fears of bald people or hairy people or even our teeth, but each and every one of us have some fears in our lives. And we, when the going gets tough and the storms of life, out of fears, our fears are often exposed when things get tough, don't we? I never saw so much when COVID hit. I never saw as much fear as I thought I would see in God's people. I really didn't. Jesus wants to displace your fear with faith. Over in the 4th chapter of Mark, beginning about the 35th verse, "And the same day when the eve was come, he said unto them, Let us pass over unto the other side. And then when they had sent away the multitude, they took him even as he was in the ship, and there was also him other little ships. And there arose a great storm in the wind, and the waves beat on the ship, so that it was now full. And he was in the hinder part of the ship, asleep on a pillow, and they awake him, and say unto him, Master, carest thou not that we perish? And he arose and rebuked the wind and said unto the sea, Peace be still. And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. And he said unto them, Why are ye so fearful? How is it that you have no faith? And they feared exceedingly and said one to another, What manner of man is this, that even the wind and the sea obey him?" Let us pray. Dear Lord, thank you for this day, and thank you for your faith, Lord. Having faith in you, Lord, will see us through. Even during times of trouble, when times are, the world seems to be closing in on us, Lord, we can put our faith in you that you will see us through. You didn't say you'd shelter us from the storms, but you said, Lord, you would see us through them. Bless those that are here tonight and bless those that couldn't come. Remember those sick people, Lord, especially those, Lord, that that's been in ICU, Lord, and those that have had the COVID. Lord, we ask you to heal them and bring them back this way. But most of all, Lord, restore their faith in you. Forgive us of any sins that we've committed this evening. In Christ's name we ask it all. Amen. Passage begins out on that day when evening came. It had been a long day for Jesus Christ. He'd been preaching all day to the crowds that had gathered, and I was thinking about it. We're talking about being able to hear. And as Forrest mentioned, speak loudly, right? Can you imagine the crowd that pressed around Jesus? And he would have had to speak loudly, wouldn't he? They didn't have sound system like we've got today. He would have had to speak so everyone could hear. And he'd been doing this all day. So he had been under great pressure. And it says actually that he got in a boat and went out a little way from shore to get away from the throng and preached to them out of the boat so that the people could see him and they would not all be pressed up against him. In Mark, the third chapter and 20th verse, it says, "Then he went home, such a large crowd gathered again that Jesus and his disciples couldn't even eat." They'd had a bad full day, hadn't they? I mean, it had been a full day of preaching. I was looking at, I got an email from, I think it's from TMBM, I'm not sure. But I said that backwards. Tennessee Baptist Mission Board. Okay. Anyway, it's talking about, it was an invitation for pastors. And they've got a thing they call off the grid. And it's 3 days that a pastor can take and just get away and unwind, okay, per se. But then I looked at the events and I thought, boy, that's really good. That sounds good. But then I looked at the events that they had and, Dora, I don't think you and I will go. It's backpacking on the Appalachian Trail.
I don't think so.
Or else golfing for 3 days. And I said, no, I don't believe either one of those would fit in with me. I'm not a backpacker. I don't do any hiking anymore. To me, hiking is going from the living room to the kitchen. Amen? That's about all my hiking that gets done. But we find that all day Jesus had been pressured. And his preaching and out in the hot sun. So by nightfall, I assure you, he was tired. He was exhausted. And he did what he often did. He said, "Hey guys, let's leave this crowd so I can get some rest." Now Jesus Christ is what? He is Lord of the Sabbath. And he understood the value of resting. I've heard of people that will go to work and will work for 7 days a week and on and on. In fact, I had a brother that was working Ford Motor Company, and he would work 7 days a week, and he would do it for months on end. And I kept telling him, that's not healthy. You need to have rest. I will say the last company that I worked for was Pilgrim's Pride, and however how many weeks of vacation you had, either one, two, three, or four, you were required to take them. You had to take your vacation. There was none of this. People would want to be paid the extra money for their vacation. They would not allow that. You had to take your time off. And they figured that it was better for you to get away and get some rest and get some mental rest away from that plant. I agreed with them. Amen. I took every hour, every day, every minute they'd allow me off, I took off. But Jesus got in the boat, he climbed to the back of the boat, and he went to sleep. And while he was asleep, this terrible storm came up, and it was whipping this boat. And you know, we think of ships today, you know, like big old ships, and said, this is not a big old ship. This is a boat. This is what we would call a boat in today's vernacular, is a boat. But it caused the disciples to be fearful of their lives. I could not imagine being out there during a storm, on the ocean during a storm. And I've seen those pictures of those, that they're just up and down and the waves. I think I'd just go ahead and leave out. You know, that would be fearful to me. I would be like the disciples. Have you ever been in a situation where, let's say an automobile accident or something, where when it ended up, you're just thankful that I am alive? Have you been in any kind of accident where you're just thankful that I'm alive? When I was back in 1973, it was on Valentine's Day. It was February the 14th, on a Saturday, I was headed home from work. And actually, a dog ran out in front of me, and I swerved to miss the dog. And the only thing that I could remember was the car started sliding sideways, and I was thinking to myself, I'm going to wreck. And I did, because the car just flipped over. And I ended up in a ditch, upside down. And, I mean, I'm laying on the roof, and I'm trying to figure out. And finally, I got enough forethought that I seen one of the windows was broke out. And I climbed out of the car, and I got up, and I just collapsed on the bank then and sat down. Turned around, looked at the car, and the car was still running upside down. And someone came and said, we've got to turn the engine off because there's gas pouring out. So, What a relief, though, when you look back on it, you know. You've seen these pictures of on TV where they have a earthquake, and they'll dig through the rubble and they'll pull somebody out that's been in there for days. Don't you know that survival, you start saying, thank you, Lord, for allowing me to get out of this. Thank you, Lord, for taking care of me during this time. But all of us, no matter what happens to us in life, If we have Jesus Christ in our hearts, we can know survival no matter what happens. We can be one of those that does turn loose of the twig because I know Jesus has got me. Just as soon as you escape something like that, you have a spiritual revival, don't you? I do. I did. When I survived that crash, I had a spiritual revival. Why? Because it had to be God that was watching out over me. Couldn't be anything else. So how can we survive in the storms of life? In our scripture tonight, the disciples were told what? There's a crowd here. Let's go to the other side. Let's go over here. Let's get away from this. But they didn't realize they were going to run into trouble. But I can tell you this. Their survival during that crossing, when the storm came up, their survival was the fact that the presence of Jesus Christ was there. Jesus was in the boat with them. So how can we experience peace in the storms? And it's simple. Get Jesus in the boat with us. Amen? We need Jesus with us. So looking ahead in this year, how can we survive this year and the years ahead? How can we get through the storms of this very year? How will we get through this COVID? How will we get through the monkeypox of all things? How will we get through these mass shootings? How will we get through the rampant immorality that's in this country? How can we survive the temptations to quit our faith? I don't understand people. When the going gets tough, where do they go? They run from God's house. They stay away from God's house. And then they wonder why things are not going good in their life. Do you ever think about that? You stay away from God's house. You say, well, I go to church and there's still bad things. Yes, you do. But I assure you this, they're worse if you're not going to God's house. They're worse than the fact that you don't have any people, any fellow Christians to help you, to see you, to give you encouragement. You lose that if you don't go to God's house. How can you survive the pressures of just everyday life? How many of you have noticed that groceries are going up? How many of you have noticed that the gas prices are high? Oh, that's right. It went down 50 cents. So, but look at that, the cost of everything. How hard it is to do things anymore. How can we survive a stormy marriage? Divorce is rampant in this country. And now then we're to settle the divorce problem, they just don't get married. Now they just live together. Now the way they can split without any permanent attachment, I guess you would say. How can we survive criticism? If you're following Jesus Christ, I assure you, you are going to suffer criticism. In America today, we're trying to do away with Jesus Christ everywhere you look. How can we survive the bad news that we get every year, every day, every hour? If you're hoping to go through life without pressure, without criticism, without temptations, without bad news, without tragedy, then I can tell you this, you're living on Fantasy Island because there's no such place. To survive, we must know that Jesus is in the boat with us. And there's a lot of advantages to having Jesus with you in the boat. I'll name about four of them tonight and then we'll close. First one. First advantage of having Jesus with you is that you now have a sense of direction. In verse 35 there it says, let us go. And where did they go? To the other side. They had a place to go, didn't they? If we will follow Jesus, He will give you a purpose in life. People are saying every day, why am I here? Where am I going? Romans 8:28 says, and we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are called according to His purpose. Jesus gave His disciples instructions or directions. We can look in the Bible for our own direction. If we need direction and how we should approach a situation, we can find it in God's Word. We have a purpose as a body of believers here at Mount Zion Baptist Church. We are to be what? We are to be the light for Jesus. We are to be an encouragement, first of all, to one another. I don't know about you, but I couldn't stand it if I couldn't go to church. I couldn't stand it. I've had an occasion before that due to being in a hospital or being away or something and not go to church. And when I come back, it feels like I've been gone forever. So we have a purpose if Jesus is in the boat with us. We also are given a sense of direction. We're given a sense of direction, I'm sorry. But we're also giving assurance of eternal life. If there's no other reason to follow Jesus Christ, that's a great one. I'm going to heaven. I've got a heavenly home. The Bible says He went to prepare a place for me. And I am ready for it. So no matter what happens here, the message He gave His disciples was, you're going to make it to the other side. You understand? Did you get that analogy there? We are going to make it to the other side. He told the disciples, you're going to get through the storms of life and you're going to make it to the other side. He's telling me the same thing. There's going to be storms in my life. The waves are going to be tossed and it's going to be scary. But I'm going to make it to the other side. We are saved and we are saved for eternity. Hebrews 6:19. Which hope we have as an anchor of the soul, but sure and steadfast, which entereth into that within the veil. Whether the forerunner is for us entered, even Jesus made an high priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. In the New Testament times, it said that a lot of the harbors they had to bring the ships into, they'd have a sandbar out at the edge of it, and at low tide, the ships couldn't make it in. So that what they would do, they would come to the sandbar and they would stop there and they'd throw their anchor on the other side of the sandbar. And then when high tide came up and their ship came up, it would simply pull them into the harbor. Jesus Christ is your anchor. And one day when you have passed through this life, when that high tide has come, He's going to pull you right into the harbor, right into safety. Jesus is our anchor. He's in heaven. And the anchor is the guarantee that one of these days His ship will make it into the harbor. 2 Timothy 1:12, for this cause I also suffer these things. Nevertheless, I am not ashamed, for I know whom I have believed and am persuaded that He is able to keep that which I committed unto Him against that day. We're kept by the power of God. There were storms, and there's many storms been that we see in the Bible. One that stands out right off the bat would have been Noah. Noah was in a storm, wasn't he? I mean, a big storm. And I mean, think about this. Noah didn't have to worry about falling out of the boat, did he? You know why? Because God shut the boat, didn't He? God shut the door. Now, he may have fell down. That sea might have been rough. I don't know. He may have fell down, but he never fell out. That's the same thing for us. We may fall down, but we can get back up, and we will never, ever fall out because God has us. He has shut us in. If Jesus is on board, we have a sense of direction. We have assurance of eternal life. With Jesus on board, He gives us stability during times of crisis. There are times. All of us face it. I like this when it talks about in verse 37, this storm came up suddenly. They didn't look out and say, well, there's clouds over there, we might ought to hurry. There wasn't no clouds, they just went out in the ship, and all of a sudden, here it was, is on top of them. We've had some of those here lately at home. The other day, Joe and I was driving home, and by the time we got home, it came a storm. It was a storming at home. So they come up suddenly, don't they? Our storms, we have a lot of them. They might be financial storms, something we just out of our control. We have doctor bills. We have all of these things. It's just out of our control. We have a relationship storm or a storm of illness. Sometimes we get that phone call that's one of our family members has passed away. I can remember as a 14-year-old boy. Got up and we were getting ready. My niece was there with us and helping me and Dad get ready. Dad was going to work and I was going to school. And she had stayed with us to prepare breakfast for us. And I got a phone call, and it was a nurse at the hospital in Sweetwater, Tennessee. Said, your dad said stay home, that your mother just passed away. Now let me tell you, for a 14-year-old boy, that was hard. And she was saying, don't go anywhere, stay there. Your dad will be home in a little while. And the only thing I knew to do, anyway, my older brother was working there on the farm. He came up to make sure we was getting off to school. And he walked in and we told him. And so I'll never forget that day. That one phone call I'll never forget as long as I live. Bad news comes. You may go to the doctor. Like Miss Debbie's talking about, she had to go and she's got cancer again. You know, one diagnosis. We've had people, friends that we had that told them they weren't going to make it. Storms. But I can tell you this. In your life right now, you may be going through a cyclone or a hurricane or all kinds of trouble. Disobedience can bring a storm in your life. Do you realize that? Jonah had one, didn't he? He disobeyed God and he was in a storm, wasn't he? Many times storms come our way. And you know what? When you get through the storm, you're stronger on the other side. I've said all along, experience is a good teacher. Sometimes it's a hard teacher. If you don't learn from your mistakes, guess what? You're doomed to repeat them, right? Jesus rises up and he calms the sea. The main storm that Jesus was concerned about wasn't the storm of the sea and the waves and the wind. The storm he was concerned about was the heart of his disciples. What they had lost, they had so much fear in their heart. Fear is looking at the storm. Faith is looking at your Savior. And fear is looking at the circumstances, but faith is looking at your God. I like the 39th verse where it says, and he arose. We're going to hear that repeated, aren't we? And he arose. Huh? He arose not only out of this ship, out of sleep, but he arose out of the dead, didn't he? And it says what? He rebuked the wind. It's one thing about it. We can be sure of one thing. If we have Jesus, we may go down, but we're never going under. Amen? He'll see us because one day we'll be going above. We'll be going up, not down. And the last point I wanted to make tonight, when Jesus is on board, you get a greater appreciation for who Jesus Christ really is. And I like that 44th verse. What manner of man is this? Whew, goodness. Even the winds and the waves obey him. You know, I can't... The disciples had seen so much. And I guess they realized that he had power over people. But they didn't realize that he had power even over nature itself. He had power to stop the wind, to stop the waves. Psalm 107:24, witness the works of the Lord, his awesome deeds in the ocean depths. This tells us that in the deep waters, we can even see God's power right there at work. Only God knows what you will face in the days ahead. And you and I can be assured of his peace. Philippians 4, 6, and 7. Be careful for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. And the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. I am one who can tell you I have experienced that peace that passes all understanding. I think if you're a Christian, each of us probably have. At one time, there was a peace when the world would look at you and say, that's crazy. You can't be at peace. Yes, I can. So those four things, a sense of purpose and direction, an assurance of eternal life, stability during unexpected crises that come in your life, and a deeper appreciation of who Jesus Christ really is. Those four things, if we have Jesus in our heart, keep him in the boat with you. Amen. Everybody stand. We'll be